Hello and welcome to the big picture. During election times, every political party and its leaders are busy formulating strategies to woo as many voters of different communities and groups into the fold. However, there is a lot of hypocrisy in the way this takes place. Though on the face, the parties claim that they don't approach voters on the basis of their religion or caste, every party virtually indulges in it, some even blatantly. The recent meeting of Congress President Sonia Gandhi with Imam Syed Bukhari of Delhi Jama Masjid had raised a furore and had come in for severe criticism, especially from the BJP leadership. However, yesterday, BJP President Rajnath Singh did almost exactly the same thing, meeting the Shia clerics in Lucknow. The question is, should political leaders appeal to caste and religious leaders at all? Or is it fair enough to do so as long as it is not just one community, caste or religious leaders that they meet? Or as a secular nation, is it best to keep the religious leaders out of electoral politics and stop wooing them? To discuss this, I have with me Swami Agnivesh, social activist, Prof. Mridula Mukherjee of Center for Historical Studies, JNU, Kamal Faruqi, former chairman, Delhi Minorities Commission, and Vinod Sharma, political editor, Hindustan Times. Welcome to all of you. Swami Agnivesh ji, I would like to come to you first. How do you look at this whole thing of, you know, this is not a new thing, it is not the first time that it's happening, but in every election we hear this very hypocritical arguments going on between different political parties about, you know, meeting religious leaders and all. Is this something that we should just accept and go ahead, or is it something that we need to discuss and debate?
We should not just discuss and debate, Girish ji. We should rather condemn this attitude.
Right.
Because this is utter opportunism. It's rank hypocrisy. And therefore, a person like me, I can never accept this type of a behavior on the part of the politicians. They go down to any extent, they stoop to any extent.
Right.
Like, as you rightly said, I was amazed to see Sonia Gandhi meeting with this Imam Bukhari,
right,
Ahmad Bukhari or whoever. You know, it's not just BJP who criticize, they have criticized because of their political angle. But I felt very uncomfortable as a citizen of this country. I could not accept this type of a hobnobbing with these obscurantist religious leaders. And I'm sure it's not going to make much of a difference for Sonia Gandhi or her party,
right,
either. But similarly, when I see Arvind Kejriwal going to file his nomination or whatever decision to contest from Benares, the first thing he does is goes and takes a dip in the Ganges. Then he goes to the temple, Baba Vishwanath, offers his pura puja part. What is this? Why you have to do that? And you rightly pointed out meeting of this and that. Many of these politicians, they find out a particular muhurat to find out, file their nominations.
Yes.
So all of these things show how weak they are, how insecure they are, and to what extent they can go to appease or to seek blessings from this Baba and that Baba. It's amazing. I mean, they have got no conviction of their own, whatever religious or spiritual, and therefore I find that they are out to dupe the voters, to cheat the voters, that look, we are meeting your religious leader, we are meeting that other religious leader, and they are appealing to the baser instincts of the people.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Mr. Farooq, would you agree with that? Appealing to the baser instincts of the people, you know, completely the constitution talks of something else, all our political leaders indulge in something completely different.
I 100% agree with Swamiji, in fact. 100% agree with it, because one, that this is basic, against the basic ethos of our politics, in fact. And two, that all those people, whether it's Congress or BJP or any other person, I do not know when they will come to the real voter, in fact. None of the Muslim voters think on these lines at all. None of the Hindu leaders, voters think on these lines. Please believe me, all these people who are meeting those religious people, yes, in your individual life, you can meet them, you could have respect for them, you can pray, you can have a dip, whatever. But when you are into politics, you have to be away from it. What Mrs. Sonia Gandhi did, yes, it was not appreciated. I am the person who said that it is not going to make any dent on the Muslim vote at all. But what Mr. Rajnath Singh yesterday was worse. But it was the other way around. Mr. Bukhari came to Sonia Ji's house. Mr. Rajnath Singh went to their houses, both for Khalid Rashid Frangi Mahalia and Kalbi Jawad. What actually they are trying to do? They were the only people who were criticizing it. If I am criticizing, I am criticizing for both, whether it is Congress or BJP or AAP. But for them, it's a very selective kind of thing. I think we should stop it. I cannot go to the extent of saying that the election commission should take a note of it, but the political parties themselves should have some kind of code of conduct for themselves. They should not indulge into all these kind of things. And believe me, whether it is one Baba or the other Imam or other Mufti or another Guru sir, they are not going to affect the have any dent on the voter, because Indian voter is much more wiser than all these people.
Professor Mukherjee. Prof. Mukherjee, this is, you know, historically speaking also, this is not something which has happened overnight. It has been, you know, over a period of time we have been witnessing this kind of thing in Indian politics. Was it anyway better when we began as a nation?
I certainly think so. I think, if you go back to the Nehru period,
yes,
there's no doubt about it. After all, Nehru talked about scientific temper and all these things which Swamiji has talked about. There's no question about going to Babas and waiting for Muhurats and this and that and the other. The whole trend was, and there's no question that he would go and ask religious leaders to get their
followers
to give votes mythical for the party. Or
in several times, mythical followers.
Mythical followers. So I don't think, I certainly think that, you know, and I think, you see, in the days of the freedom struggle and in the first two decades, I would say, of independence, the culture was very different. They had fought against communalism. They understood its danger. After all, Jawaharlal Nehru called the threat from the RSS a fascist threat.
Right.
When Gandhiji died, he said there is a conspiracy going on now to actually take over the country. It's a coup d'etat. He called Gandhiji's assassination as the first assassination, and he said they are planning a series of these as part of a coup d'etat to capture power. So where was the question of messing with religious leaders, or whether it was Sardar Patel who put the RSS behind bars and all that? I think what is also very, I would say, retrograde now is not even an attempt to make this demarcation.
Exactly.
You know, this intrusion of religion into politics is what we call communalism.
Right.
Everybody has a right to their religion. People have a right to worship. They have a right to their minority institutions under our constitution.
Article 2, yeah.
But the intrusion of religion into politics is against the constitution. Number two, I think I agree with Kamalji when he says it's also contempt for the people.
Absolutely.
You don't think that people in India can distinguish between their religious interests and their political and economic and other interests. I think this, it is a contempt for the people. It's an underestimation of our people. And I think somehow now I always feel that it is our politicians, or rather our whole political system, which is failing our people. It is said that people get the system they deserve. But I don't see that as true when I look around me.
Absolutely.
People are far more advanced
Absolutely.
In their understanding, in their expectations, but the system is failing them.
The system is failing. Vinod, you know, as Prof. Mukherjee was pointing out, these issues don't even actually nowadays, you know, see any kind of serious debate at all on when these things happen. It is just accepted now that, you know, these political leaders go and meet these kind of religious leaders, woo them, you know, try to get votes from them. You know, have we seen a retro, as Prof. Mukherjee was saying, this retrograde thing happening? From being progressive, we have become very regressive.
Girish, I have to make a different point, you know, and which I think other eminent panelists may disagree with. But I'm making this point in all seriousness.
Yes.
And I think that I want all of them, with all their wisdom, to take a look at it. In 1984, when the Congress Party did not even go to the Sikhs for seeking votes, there was a person called Atal Bihari Vajpayee who took a position and who reached out to the Sikhs to who drew them out to participate in the 84 vote. And though his party lost heavily, the secular character of the vote was maintained. I see I get some sense of deja vu because of the kind of campaign certain political parties are today running. We know that in Muzaffarnagar and adjoining areas, the RSS workers had gone around asking for votes on Hindu unity. Now, in that backdrop, for whatever reasons, when I see Mr. Rajnath Singh, who is contesting from Lucknow and who needs the Shia votes, reaching out to the Shia, I see it with a degree of circumspection as a silver lining. Because, you know, even under force, under some degree of expediency, even if they are trying to be inclusive in reaching out to the people, I think that it is better than a major political party which hopes to form a government totally ignoring a huge Muslim majority which numbers about 20 crore in our country. You know, similarly, I think that because of this sectarian appeal, which has to be shunned progressively over a period of time, you know, we do not have any political party, mercifully, in this country which can claim the support of the Muslims, which is a Muslim party. Though we have an aberration in Assam, but in other parts of India, we have no such aberration, and wherever these aberrations are there, those parties have a limited appeal. The majesty of Indian secularism, Girish, is that the trust of the minorities rests with the people, with the leaders who are not from one amongst them.
Okay.
They come from a different persuasion.
No, maybe
not. I think that, you know, this is a point we must debate and we must see how we can improve on this situation.
Okay, I think you have made it interesting. Mr. Kamal Farooq, I want to come to you. Do you agree with him?
No, in fact.
He's bringing very contemporary issues on hand. He says, Muzaffarnagar, what all has happened in Muzaffarnagar? Would you see this Rajnath Singh's visit to Kalbe Jawad in Lucknow, a Shia cleric, as some kind of, you know, attempt to overcome what has been done?
No, respect.
In his own interest, because he wants to win that seat.
No, most respectfully, I disagree with Vinod Bhai. Why, in fact, he gave one example of Sikh community. Yeah, that was at that particular time they were feeling a little isolated, and Congress committed a blunder that time. They are paying the price even now that they tried to isolate them. That was a different ball game. In fact, that was bringing the entire Sikh community into the, but they were not approaching through the religion. Now, as far as the Muzaffarnagar is concerned, it's altogether a different thing. We have just now seen the entire political system of the BJP, the entire methodology. Rather, they have done a kind of salt on the wounds of the Muslims. Now, at one particular point of time, they are making all kind of very communal kind of remarks. They, at the same time, they have no love for Muslims. Let me tell you one thing. If they have any love for Muslims, these kind of remarks would have been objected by Rajnath Singh. He has not objected to what Amit Shah said. But it is only for the vote, in fact, that they have gone to both these leaders, both Khalid Rashid, Frankie Mahal, as well as Kalpit Jafwad. So there is a different, basically, they are trying to exploit it. If they are true, yes, I am happy if the Muslims are being approached by all the political parties that will solve your problem. But what actually we are discussing today, it is not the religious leaders, be it's a imam or some guru or some baba. They cannot bring the vote.
They cannot bring the vote.
You have to bring it.
But and you're convinced that these kind of would you will call it half-hearted approaches to no,
not half-hearted. They are fooling Muslims.
They're fooling Muslims.
They are fooling Muslims.
Yes, Vinod, very quickly.
Yeah. No, you see, I think Farooq, you know, Farooqi Saab, I have great regard for Mr. Farooqi, and I quite respect him for his views, whatever he stands for. You know, I think that, Mr. Farooqi, you made the point. You see, the two-timing nature of certain political parties, that in one part of India, they are seeking vote in the name of Hindu unity, and in another part of India, they are trying to reach out to religious leaders for a sectarian appeal to a religious minority. Now, I think the majority which is sought to be swayed behind the slogan of Hindu nationalism, military nationalism, national security, corruption, everything, it's a Molotov cocktail of a campaign which can burn a whole lot of vital institutions and presidents in our country.
No, but Vinod, what is the point?
This contradiction brings out, Girish, it exposes the sympathy that they are trying to generate amongst the majority. That the majority is not blind, it is also watching, it is seeing that nobody is actually talking about the welfare of the people in the manner welfare is understood.
That's the point.
People are sought to be divided.
Your earlier point. You were trying to create a hypothesis that maybe this this is some kind of an attempt.
It is, yes. Yeah, this is not a perfect hypothesis, but there is a line of argument there,
yes,
which can be perhaps built upon.
Okay.
Because maybe that we should not approach these obscurantists, these Molanas, self-styled Molanas.
Okay.
But surely a way has to be found to draw these people into the biggest festival of democracy, that they should not sit at home they should not turn out and say that democracy is being called a revenge these days. Democracy is a revenge. And now if one revenge is being exercised, it's going to be met with another revenge. What we want, Girish, that vote be cast with a degree of equanimity of mind, with a degree of duty, and not out of pique or not out of anger or revenge, a sense of revenge.
I mean, that nobody will dispute what you're saying. Swami Agnivesh, do you see any point in what Vinod Sharma is saying, that maybe this is some kind of an attempt by somebody like Rajnath Singh to undo some of the things which his party or some of the leaders in his party are trying to do? And another thing is, as Mr. Kamal Farooqi says, that these kind of approaches do not really have any electoral harvest.
Well, I agree with Kamal Farooqi and I do not agree with Mr. Vinod Sharma, though I respect him very much. I call it hypocrisy of the first order. I would like to know from Rajnath Singh, does he really have genuine respect for these Maulanas whom he went to seek their blessing from? Absolutely not. Right. He's just trying to play the trick and try to dupe the voters. So, you see, this goes against the basic idea, basic principle of our Indian Constitution.
Right.
Article 51A, it talks about the fundamental duties of every citizen, talks about inculcating scientific temper. Now, as a citizen of India, these politicians have failed. They are not promoting scientific temper, rather they are promoting obscurantism. And therefore, I think that they are a liability. Each one of them, I am saying, I am not just blaming one or the other, but I find as a class, political class, they have failed this country, and I don't see much of a future for this country as long as politicians keep on playing this fraud on people's sentiments and emotions.
Those are very strong words, Prof. Mukherjee. Obscurantism. We are regressing, as you pointed out. Are we regressing towards obscurantism? Especially the political parties trying to use this kind of thing instead of educating people. What Nehru, in his high moral, which he used to use.
That I completely agree. I was very surprised when a few weeks ago, Shri Ravi Shankar,
yes,
gave a statement where, right, he basically asked his followers to vote for a particular political party, very clearly indicating the BJP. Now, here is a person who's got enormous following because of what he's contributed in the field of spirituality, yoga, etc., etc. He's also built himself up as a man of peace,
right,
and therefore has gone to meet even the Taliban and this and that. Okay. Religious leaders can play a role in peacemaking, in this, but to actually assume that you have therefore the right to guide your followers as to what political choices they should make in an election, I think that's where the boundaries are
getting
stuck. I object to that because I don't think you have the right to do that. Let me come to the question of leadership. Why are we assuming that only religious leaders are leaders in their communities? there are political leaders who are leaders social with leader. Links to their communities.
Social leader.
There are social
social activists.
With people who do social reform and other things. Now, why is it we are talking about why political parties and politicians go to or allow leaders to come to them and these leaders are giving diktats? I think that's where the problem. We are not saying that you should not approach
yes.
or talk to people who are influential in certain communities. You know, but there is a political and other, there's academic leadership. There are people in different walks of life.
No.
Here, it's a very simple question of the intrusion of religion into politics. Or no, politics Mukherjee, based I have religious identity.
No, Professor Mukherjee, I have another question. I have another, in fact, a thought in my mind. There is always this furor which happens when a political leader, whether it's Sonia Gandhi or anybody, somebody else, going and meeting a Muslim cleric or a Muslim leader, Muslim religious leader of any of these kinds. But you don't see the same kind of furor when a Hindu religious leader is met by any of these political leaders. Why does that happen?
No, it is equally condemnable. I'm saying people
it is, but we don't that's find the kind of, we don't find the kind of furor doesn't happen.
No, like Swamiji. Swamiji is an ardent opponent of this. I'm saying he would always...
Swami Agnivesh is different. I'm not... Let us say a political leader goes and meets a Shankaracharya or somebody at this point of time. Do we see the same kind of furor happening?
I'm saying it. The people who do the furor.
Yeah.
I fully agree. Yeah. Earlier, you might have seen a picture of Mrs. Indira Gandhi.
Yes.
She was seeking blessing from Devarha Baba.
Right.
Who was sitting up on a machan platform, putting his leg on the head of Mrs. Gandhi.
We have seen him with another former prime minister also.
Yes. So this type of, you know, blessing and all of these Sai Babas and this and prostrating in front of Sai Baba therein. So we have seen and it's really revolting. I mean, I just can't put up with
But Swamiji, my question
is, by any chance,
one second. My question is, but it doesn't, you know, it doesn't lead or result in this kind of outrage or furor. Why?
Well, I think it depends on who really takes it up. And we should all condemn, we should condemn all of these things in one sweep, because compromising with one and the other will be really not doing real service to our country and constitution. And I find this type of, you know, on the one side, you are promoting communal politics in Muzaffarnagar. On the other side, you are seeking the blessings of these clerics. Huh?
Right.
So this is like playing, running with the hare and hunting with the hound.
Absolutely.
I mean, you want to say, that, oh, we are clever people and we can do anything.
No, as Professor Mukherjee pointed out earlier, that, you know, you're taking the people for granted. You're trying to, you know, insult the intelligence of the people while doing it. Yes, Mr. Faruqi?
No, by any chance, Masayke, none of us have got any disrespect for the religious leaders.
Right.
They have got their own, Dr. Saab very rightly said, they have got their own role to play in the peacemaking and whatnot. But for heaven's sake, leave the politics for it. And they should be wise enough to understand that arm Hindu, arm Muslim, do not vote according to these Babas or Maulvis or Imams. They vote according to their own thinking about the perception of the politics. So, they are not doing any justice to themselves as well as to that particular community. Muslims are being so much marginalized for this purpose. Muslims are so much suffering because of these stupid. Nobody is doing the real work. The Muslims are suffering in the field of education and economy and all other things, empowerment. Instead of doing this, approach to those people who are working for the upliftment of Muslims, their women folk, even the madrasas, if you really want to. But don't ask at the particular point of time when the elections are going on, don't go there and ask for their blessing for the vote and thinking that they would perhaps be the cause of voting for or against them.
Yes.
I'd like to support that. Yes. I think
I'll come to you, Vinod.
Right from after independence, this has been a weakness even in the Congress.
Right.
In fact, nationalist Muslims, this has been their major complaint, that they got sidelined after independence because for electoral purposes, the Congress also started bending towards those who were religious leaders thinking wrongly. I think certainly in the long run, that they were the ones who had the support among the masses.
Right.
And this is so you constantly marginalize the secular sections among the community,
right,
the non-religious leaders of the community.
Absolutely.
I'd like to emphasize this.
Absolutely.
Your assumption is that only the religious leaders are the leaders of the community, the others are something else.
Absolutely. You know? Yes, yes, Vinod.
Well, I think that...
No, Vinod, my question to you is, as a journalist, you know, as a journalist, you think that when political parties, leaders approach these kind of people, they genuinely think that these people can bring in votes?
Well, if they don't approach them, if they don't have the capacity to mobilize votes, they surely have a capacity to lead the voters astray in a tense situation. And I think, no, they do have a great capacity to do that.
Right.
You know, we have seen it happening in communal rights situations.
So they have more nuisance
situations.
So you're saying they have more nuisance values.
I'm not the one who wants any degree of sanctity accorded to them or any degree of legitimacy accorded to them. But I think that these people should be kept on the neutral side and not at least encouraged to, you know, spread the fire which is lit somewhere else. You see, you know, there are two kinds of communalism in this country. The communalism of the majority and that of the minority.
Right.
They both feed on each other.
Absolutely.
And it's always good to douse one fire. Absolutely. So that the other fire doesn't take force from it.
Okay.
And, you know, this is something
interesting.
It's a practical approach.
No, Vinod, I think you have made very interesting points. Swamiji, do you agree with that? You know, at least, you know, they have, if they don't have electoral value, they have a nuisance value.
No. But whatever value, you know, I don't agree with this point of view.
Ah.
And I find that they do have electoral value also.
They have.
In a sense of, in a negative sense.
Right.
For example, I find any number of political leaders going to get blessing from the Sacha Sauda.
Right.
Mr. Ram Rahim.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So, I mean, the person who is embroiled in all sorts of CBI investigation for murder and rape charges.
Yeah. Right.
This is the time when he bargains with these political leaders.
Right.
That you have to give me assurance that I will not be proceeded against.
Right.
And he gets those assurances and is playing safe. So, this way. Secondly, Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Ji. He just not only appealed indirectly for voting his followers to vote for BJP. He got a ticket for his own follower.
Right.
Mahesh Giri is a candidate from East Delhi.
Right.
And he is a devout follower of Sri Ravi Shankar.
Right.
No other reason.
Right.
That on the one side, you are blessing the party. On the other side, it's a quid pro quo, like, you know.
Right.
So,
right.
This type of an approach by religious people to dabble in politics indirectly is something I don't agree with.
Okay, sir. I think on that note we need to end, but it has been a very interesting debate. This is a problem which cuts across political parties, but as Vinod says that, you know, they have nuisance, they may not have electoral value, but they have a huge nuisance value, but still it's best, as Prof. Mukherjee says, to keep these people out of politics and stop insulting the voters of this country, thinking that, you know, they will get carried away by these kind of leaders. Thanks to all my guests, Swami Agnivesh, Vinod Sharma, Kamal Faruqi and Professor Mridula Mukherjee. Please keep watching. We'll come back with another issue on Big Picture same time tomorrow.